As I've just stated, maybe if possible, you can recollect about how it first all began, when how does Rinpoche first come to know about you? If possible, you can give me, you know, how many years ago, and if not, it's okay. And how he came to know about you, and what is your first impression of Rinpoche at that time?
Thank you. I think it was the
fifteen years ago.
I think that it was. And he was recognized as the international of the Zen Kendo, whose monastery is the best in eastern part of Tibet. And he was recognized as the reincarnation of Tsem Kambo. Then I think first teacher of the Rinpoche, as far as I understand, is the Song Rinpoche. And then Ladi Rinpoche, Kensu Chambayishi has the good relationship with me.
Mm-hmm.
Already Rinpoche knows about me through him.
Oh, I see.
And then he sent somebody to ask me, it is possible for him to come to study with me here in the monastery. And then I was happily offered, honestly offered, on the way offered the time for him to come to study with me. Then he decided to come. He stayed first times maybe few months in the monastery. And he had already studied Buddhist philosophy with other gurus like Song Rinpoche and Kisu Chambayishi. And he studied with me mainly about Pramana Vatika.
So,
Pramana Vatika.
Logic.
Logic. Logic. Yes. Logic. Written by Indian master Dhammakirti.
Dhammakirti,
yes. Dhammakirti is his study. And then he, every day, and we had classes.
Yes.
Every day we had classes. He was very sharp.
It's very sharp.
Very sharp. Extremely sharp.
Mm-hmm.
Study very well.
Mm-hmm.
And my first impression about him is the I found him, of course, very intelligent person, and he was very kind. He had very kind heart, you know, to help other people. While he was here, while he studied with me, and he had projected, you know,
projects
to support poor Tibetan families. You know. He himself,
that's right,
traveled it from door to door of the monastery,
mm-hmm.
and whenever he found it, the problems, you know,
mm-hmm.
some people see, no one had, you know, some have the many children, find it difficult to look after them, and some old persons, you know, in which he went door by door in here in the area, and he supported financially, and also he supported this Tibetan medical institution. They are very poor people. They can't provided many places for the sick people. He supported a lot of things, this God. So, very kind in the end, he did, of course, very gentle. And then he went back for some time. Again he came, I think maybe a few years, studied continuously with me.
Oh, I see. Yes. So he stayed here for a couple
to
of months?
To stay here a couple of months, then he went
he
back.
He went back. Oh.
And then after I can come here.
I see, just like this.
Yeah. We had very close relationship.
So he studied under you personally?
Yes.
I see.
Yes.
Wow. Wow. Yes. Wonderful. And this relationship lasts for a few years after
yeah,
that?
Yeah, a few years.
Oh, okay. Wow, that's really nice. So, if you can remember, one of the interesting questions that people always ask is, how was he like? You know, when he was a monk, he was in here. Is he still very different from what you see now? Because now he's, you know, he's giving Dharma teaching. He's so, how do you see a lot of differences in his period of study here? And now he's like getting to 40.
Very active now.
Oh, still very active.
Very active. Then my impression when he was studying with me, what I found it him as a very kind person, good person. He always wanted to help poor people. See? Very compassionate.
Very compassionate.
Very compassionate. Mm. At that time, he didn't have much, I think, financial for himself.
Yes.
Whatever he had, he wanted to support.
Oh,
that is the... And as a result, now he has, you know, he's benefiting many people.
That's right.
And also, I was so glad that he was able to come back to support his monastery.
Yes. He's very young.
I think his ambition is to help others.
Yes.
That is part of the practice of the Bodhicitta.
Oh, Bodhicitta. He already observed this quality in him when he was young, even during his studies.
Yes.
So he doesn't just study and study. He's interested in Dharma knowledge, but he also interested.
And very practical.
Practical person.
Very practical.
Mm.
And what he wanted, I think, we had a lot of discussion about how to present teachings to the modern world. To the modern world. I think my impression he has, because he was educated in America.
Mm.
He has already a very good base of the modern knowledge.
Yes.
And apart from that, I think he has good qualities, you know, and compassion, all that.
Mm.
So he has very good skills, you know, to explain, to present it, his philosophy thoughts to the modern people. How to relate it with his teaching to everyday life.
Ah, even at that time, he's already thinking about how to spread Dharma to the modern people.
How to relate it to the modern life, in everyday life.
And you have an active discussion together.
Oh, we have sometimes, you know, we do with class, we have just chat about everyday life. What is your aim?
Teachers,
things like that,
right.
Conversation.
Oh, that's very nice. So coming back to that point, then maybe you can tell us roughly, because I noticed that you spoke very good English. And that's
English is good.
It's very good. And because we heard from Rinpoche that you have been giving teachings in England some time ago, maybe you can tell us about your time overseas and before you come back to Japan.
Yes, I came from Tibet, you know, at the age of the 25. That was in 1959.
Yes.
And then I went to the Baksa Baksa.
Baksa is
the first re-established Buddhist study SUIT universities. I went there, and until we moved to the south, that was the, I think in 69 I stayed. Then I spent a few years more here after we moved it south. Then after that, I think 81. Mm-hmm. Yes, I was sent to teach the Buddhism in England, in London.
London.
Buddhist. Jamyang Buddhist Center.
Oh, yes. That's now is it the Lama Zopa Center?
Now it's Lama Zopa.
Yeah, I've been there once. I was studying in England for 5 years.
I see. So, you went there.
Yes, I went there many times. Yeah. So you gave teachings there. How long were you there in England?
I was in England from 1981 up to 82.
Just 1 year?
Yes.
1 year or so.
From 81 to 88.
Oh, 88.
Okay. Almost about 8 years.
8 years?
Yes.
And that's when you learn the English.
Which college you studied?
Oh, I came from Cambridge University.
Cambridge, you know.
So it's very close to London. Now there's a lot of Dharma centers going, activities going on in England and Europe.
I see.
But that's also because we have the fortune to have teachers like you to go there and spread Dharma at that time. Now it's flourishing, it's going very well.
Yes.
Very nice.
It's true.
What?
It's true.
Oh, so after 1988, then you come back directly to Japan to give...
Yes, to Japan. What happened was the... after 7 or 6 years, I was very seriously in health problem. Very seriously. And I had operation, quite an operation in London. And apart from that, I got diabetes, very serious diabetes.
Diabetes.
So it took me to heal the curds that. Well, I have the operation to heal. It took a long time. So I stayed in countryside for maybe another 2 years.
Oh, okay.
And then I come back. I went to Dharamsala.
You went to Dharamsala.
His Holiness suggested to come to Dharamsala to have treatment with Tibetan doctor. The Tibetan treatment, it helped.
It helped a lot. I see.
So, then, still, of course, I'm diabetic, you know, one tablet.
I see. So after that, you come back here.
Yeah, come back to the Devon
Hostel. And you still give regular teachings?
Regular teachings every day.
I see. Oh, no. Is it possible to ask, before you come back to Tibet, to India, excuse me, you were in Tibet, and you are also from Japon Monastery.
Yes.
And may I ask, what's your guru?
Guru, my main guru, there are two. Kensu Penatenzen Rinpoche and Shapur Ken Rinpoche. It's two. Both are now passed away.
Yes. Oh,
passed away.
I see. That's really nice. I observe there are a lot of pictures of you and His Holiness as well.
Yes.
You have a strong
I was very happy that I have seen His Holiness throne, photo throne in US.
Oh, yes.
Show me.
Yes, that's right. Yes, we hope that in future we have the fortunes to actually invite His Holiness to come to Malaysia.
Oh, that is
yes.
extremely important, would be extremely beneficial.
Yes.
If you could arrange it here, yes. To invite His
Holiness.
Yes. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yes. It would be in which He always say that He wants to
invite
and also make offerings to His Holiness in person, you know. When we can all make this one, not just to Ganden, but actually in the future we can also
offer to him.
We really hope that His Holiness can come to Malaysia and Southeast Asia.
Yeah, if you invite it, and His Holiness will definitely come.
Yes. Thank you. Now we have this Kachara house that. We have this Kachara center that comes out.
What is the name of the new center?
Our center is called Kachara House.
Kachara.
So we have Kachara House, mm-hmm. and we have, as you can see in the photo books that the other day, we actually brought it here.
Can I have?
Yes, sure.
This one?
Yes.
Oh yeah, that one.
Yes, that's the
large.
It's not enough actually. We have more and more people coming to the class.
Yes.
And it's expanding. We may have to look for a new place.
I see.
And the purpose of coming and conduct the interviews is also we want to make it into a documentary for Kachara House and also its connection to Ganden Monastery, so that we can raise funds, raise awareness of Ganden, because as you know, Jepong and Ganden, they are quite isolated, and people cannot stay here, they have to get permit. So it's not very accessible for modern people to come and visit. So we want to make into a film, and this film will be passed to the general public, and they understand more about Ganden and its connection to Kachara House. So in future, we can raise enough funds to build a retreat center.
Yes.
That's really the
main purpose. Very good person. I appreciate it.
Yeah. That's the Kachara House.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, very carry on your question. Yes.
So, what do you think, in your opinion, of the way that Kachara House itself, you know, as a do you see it like as a branch of Ganden Monastery, and how do you think Buddha Dharma, you know, in these days, we all know that it's very relevant to the modern people, but we would like to ask your opinion, you know, how what's your opinion of the spread of Buddha Dharma nowadays in Western society, and now of course in Southeast Asia, because most of us, you know, we come from we are under Mahayana training and all these things, and now Tibetan Buddhism.
We were born.
Yes, and we are all Chinese, and now we really have the fortune to understand, to get connected to Tibetan Buddhism as well, and so, and therefore all this center that's coming up. What do you think about all these things? Is it very similar?
I think it is very important these times to have centers like you have to present it, these teachings, to the people, especially in this generation, this period, the modern world, see. And Buddha Dharma is, as far as I understand, not dogmatic.
Not dogmatic.
It's not only culture, it's universal heart. So all people, what they're looking for is the peace and the inner happiness. As we understand, see, we have in this period, in modern period, technology is highly developed, and people reach on the moon. But of course, I'm not saying that you don't need the material development. Of course, you do need the science. Provide it very beneficial to the humankind, you know, in case of the medications, the traveling facilities, and so on and so on. Don't need it to go into detail. But at the same time, people have the mental, you know, course, you know, problems, you see, so much desires, anxieties, and traces. So the Buddha Dhamma, I think, it helps to pacify all these thought and mental problems. See, I think, as he already says, Buddhist teachings, Batis, Dhammas, can very well go with modern development.
That's right.
So you have a huge responsibility.
Yes, that's true. His Holiness always says about the relevance of Dhamma.
Yes.
To bring inner happiness,
inner peace.
Nice.
Inner happiness. Nice. And as I said, you have, of course, I understand Rinpoche is very keen to invite His Holiness to your center, and if you can, you know, make this possibility, with the extremely beneficial. So Lensi will be very happy. But his aim is the same as what you're doing.
That's right. Okay. Coming back to the time when Rinpoche was here, I forgot to ask, is there any special interesting story or any interesting anecdotes of Rinpoche when he was here? Anything that, you know, leave a very strong impression with you? Maybe some kind of incidents, you know, that strikes you every time you see Rinpoche, you can remember something, the incident that relates back at that time.
You mean the first time you went
out? Not just the first time, maybe during the time, the many years that you were with Rinpoche. You see, any particular incident that strikes you? By being like, oh, maybe he's being very funny, he's being casual. Because
he has the very good skills to deal with people. And he has such good qualities to make people feel happy. And his presentations always see, they give the good energy. Happy energy to the people. He was like that. Still, I found him.
Yeah, because a lot of us always wonder that now when he gives Dhamma teachings, he's very active, very like a, you know, show person, and he used gestures and jokes
Yes. He has very good humor.
Humor.
Yes.
And at that time when he was here,
make people laugh. You know, laughing is the healing. And he laughs.
Yeah, he always does that in the Dhamma teachings these days.
Yes.
And we wonder whether that was all the time in him. Okay, in that case, is it possible for you to talk about how, I don't know whether it's Rinpoche's work in at that time when he was in Ganden, so he studied a lot and he gave some other, as you mentioned about his community service, he went and served the medical center and so on. what other things in your memory has he done at that time, other than raising funds to help the monastery and also sponsor poor people and so on?
Well, I said to see he provided financial support to extended medical institution in Manipur area. Mm-hmm. And I had the impression that he might have some more project to benefit the people, not only in medical areas but also in education, so on and so forth. But most times I spent it here, so I'm sorry I can't tell you details.
It's alright. Yeah, I was thinking maybe it is something that you're not so familiar with. So on and off, he has been here for a couple of months, and as time it goes back, he comes back, and that lasts for a few years, a couple of years. I see. So, at the time when he left here and to Malaysia, as instructed by his guru to spread teachings, to spread Dharma teachings, did you talk to him at the very last instance?
Well, I met him one or two times, and Rinpoche said to me, we had communications. Rinpoche sent me letters quite often.
Oh, when he was in Malaysia?
From Malaysia.
Oh, that's constant.
Yes.
And at that time, just constant letters.
Letters.
Communication with you. Oh, I see. So, but at the time when he left, he didn't have a chance to say goodbye or anything?
Oh, I think he came, he mentioned one time that he had long to go to visit abroad. He didn't mention
particularly in Malaysia. Oh, I see. Okay. Some of the because we are going to interview some people, some lamas, but their English, they may not know English, so we need a translator. Then it will be very difficult for them because they have to stay longer. But with you, it's very easy. Very easy. Very nice. Because Rinpoche said we have to interview you because you have good English and also he really miss you a lot.
Yes, Rinpoche is very kind to me, and we have, you know, very close relationship, feeling from heart to heart.
Oh, wow. Very nice. So now we, as you can see, the Dharma teachers, you know, all these monks, they go through the education in monastic university, and eventually they become, you know, rishis and qualified Dharma teachers, and they can all go overseas, you know, abroad to teach Dharma, just like Rinpoche does. Is there any obstacles you see in, you know, the reform and, you know, Ganden, you know, because as we all can see, there are severe difficulties in the prayer hall itself, in the library, the resources, and of course, the place, the monastic university itself, is quite inaccessible to many people, foreigners, to come and learn Dharma. And do you see any things that can be done, you know, you know, not just Gamden, but also Drupal and all the university here, how to overcome those things, you know.
Problems.
Yes.
As you know, the lamas, when they go first, the difficulties, problem that they would often face is the, I think it's to understand Western people's mind and thinking. It takes a long time to understand. I think essentially all human beings have the same mentality, but at culture levels, they have the different thinkings, and so I think this takes, even from my own experience, it took quite a long time to understand. If you don't understand Western way of thinking and Western culture background, and you will find it difficult to present it, whatever suitable way to present this Buddhist teachings to the heart. So I think one of the main problems is the understanding barrier. There's a barrier between the cultures. So that is the one of the difficulties that lamas face.
And but I'm sure there are some programs here that teach them about the modern people's lives. Like, for instance, do they have to learn English? They have to learn different histories of different cultures and so on.
Yes, we had this kind of project. You know? Now His Holiness opened for young monks to learn science. The monasteries. We have classes.
Oh, I see. Science. Okay.
And trainings also have in Dharamsala sometimes. You know. So they learn the method, see how to present it.
So Rinpoche, in that case.
Chinese? Chinese.
Oh yeah.
And Tibetans, Mongolians, they have the various almost the same.
Yeah.
See, because they are born in Buddhist families. So we have not much problems to understand.
Cultural differences.
But see, one thing is, like Malaysia, Thailand, and Singapore, scientifically and technologically, very highly developed people have the high modern education. But they're still interested in their own culture, Buddhist religions. Normally, when modern science and technology start to develop, it sometimes causes those people's belief in their own culture.
Beliefs
in culture. But like Malaysia and Singapore, Thailand, although they are, you know, are living in very highly developed, scientifically and technologically, but still they have the good faith in Buddhism. That is, the, you know, I think very good.
Yes.
Yeah. So, what do you think?
Thank you.
Can you comment it on it?
I think it's true that we do value cultures, but on the other hand, it's also true that when you know people in Asia, especially in Malaysia, Singapore, even Taiwan, and people work very hard. You know, the lifestyle gets very hectic.
Yes.
Every day busy driving. Office computer
very busy,
and to the point that sometimes we don't know, you know, what's the meaning of all this. You know, is there a purpose in life? Is it something that's more fulfilling than just keep working and working? And is that, do you want
the value of life?
Yes. So we actually, you know, in Asia, you know, we start to see this problem coming up, and probably in US, in America, in over the world, that as you say, as we all get technology advanced, we know how to use computers and so on, and increase our working efficiency and all these things. But at the same time, spiritual level, it's not coming up at the same pace. In fact, we realize that we are not any happier, you know, with cars, with all these things coming. Something's missing. That's my personal opinion.
Yes,
and so when, you know, when we all first learn about Dharma, you know, Tibetan Buddhism, we find that that's a very interesting perception to life, how you can become a happier person. And we are very fortunate.
Compassion is very essential. Yes. Otherwise, you know, see, in Tibet, when I was a very small child, see, I think society is materially very poor. I must say, we have no modern light, electricity, light, power, so these things is poor, but mentally very happy, as I understand. When you see some stench, visitors comes, you will have almost meeting your dear friend. There's no feeling of the fear, stenchness, very close, good heart feeling. So, see, very peace. I think this is because of the Buddhist teachings practice. See, compassion is very important. And so, when modern technology comes, lives become almost people, first things, most priority. First, priority is give to the back money.
Ah, I see.
So they think money is everything.
so important,
everybody is thinking, forgetting the inner happiness, peace and good heart, kind understanding to each other. So, and people become mentally unhappy. So Buddhist teachings, they teach how to develop. In our education, the monasteries is not intellectual teacher. Teacher himself has give the example as an example. But I am not good. But teacher himself have to be good example to the students.
They have to practice what they teach.
Practice, and they show our everyday lives to the students.
Yes. Yeah. That's very true. That's what we actually observe. You know, we actually learn from Rinpoche and also High Lamas.
Yes.
From,
yes.
Always, what they say, and they do it through the body actions.
Yes.
is consistent.
Yes.
And they believe the benefits of Dharma because of that. This is why we cherish Dharma so much.
Yes.
How many hours is that? How
long is that?
Okay. Okay. Shouldn't take too much of your time.
Oh, my pleasure.
Yes.
Thank you so
we may actually, you know, in future, you know, because the when we are doing the biography, if there are some missing information, that everything, we may come back to here again, and if possible, we can. And request to have an audience again with you in the future. Yes, thank you very much for giving so
thank
much
you.
Everything.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Spiritually very calm when you come here. Just wish I had more time to stay here. But you know, you need a permit, that's a little bit tricky. Mark Center is like the top university.
Yes.
But they are, you know, they ask questions which is exactly what we've been talking about. You know, studying so much, what's the meaning, and it doesn't help them overcome anger and all this. And he's always been really good teaching.
Yes.
Very, very beneficial.
When I was in India, I had a long time to talk with those few people. It is possible to get rid of the anger forever. I said,